My presentation is on Monday on like model builder or whatever. Yeah. And I was going to do the model builder when we make a delineating a watershed.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah. You got a date here.
That don't know me. Before I started with ReefCheck, I did my PhD at UC Santa Cruz. Working on fish movement, and so that's what I'm going to be talking about mostly today. The causes and consequences of movement of temperate reef fishes, so the kind of fish that we see out here. And I wanted to start by just thinking a little bit about movement, because it's really not something that we think about so much, because animals move all over the place and it's just natural to us, but it's really one of the fundamental demographic or characteristics of animals and all living organisms, really, even plants or sessile invertebrates. Every organism has, at some point in their life, the possibility to move. So for sessile invertebrates, it's their larvae. For plants, it's often their seeds or their pollen. And it's essential for organisms so that they can react to environmental variation, environmental threats, changes in the environment. They can move out of the way, or they can move into areas that are more beneficial to them. And when we think about animal populations, it's also one of the three key demographic rates. There's only really three things that can change the size or the distribution of a population, and that's birth of individuals, death of individuals, or the movement of individuals within populations or in and out of populations. And so movement is really the only of those three rates that links the abundance, the number of individuals in a certain location, and the distribution. So how the distribution of individuals in our populations in space. And so, yeah, therefore it's one of the three key demographic rates. And it is important, therefore, on all these different levels of ecological organization. Oh, and by the way, if you have questions, you can just interrupt me. I don't have to do this as a lecture, like, all the way here. Please just ask. So, for individuals, it's key because it defines how they can acquire resources or how they can find mates and reproduce. And like I said, it allows them to deal with environmental stresses. They can get out of the way, or they can move in response to changing habitats. And ultimately, it affects their growth, survival, and reproduction. And that, in turn, then affects the population level, if we go up in the kind of layers of ecological organization. Like I said, it affects the abundance, so the number of individuals in the location, and their distribution by moving out of areas or into new areas. And then it also affects their what we call the gene flow, so the movement of genes between different, or within a population, or between different populations, and something that's called metapopulations, which is a collection of small local populations, and they are connected with each other by individuals moving in between. Like, you can think of it as like different countries or something, and people moving in between countries. They connect those populations. Uh-huh.
We find a lot of species moving away from this area, or are introducing new species.
Moving away from
this? Away from this Bay Area, away from this area altogether now?
No. The people starting to detect some shifts in species moving northwards because of warming, but not so much in the ocean yet, but on land, yeah. And then at an even higher level, at the community level, it affects how species interact with each other. So, for example, predation is largely influenced by the way how individuals move. They can run away, or they can swim away, or they cannot, and they get eaten. So those kinds of species interactions are really influenced by the way individuals can move, and therefore it affects the structure and function of species or populations in the community, And then there's something that's called meta-communities, which is a collection then again of local communities and the movement of populations between those communities as effects on the way how these communities change over time. And lastly, individuals can move between ecosystems, like these salmon, for example. They can move up the stream from the marine ecosystem into the headwaters of streams and connect these two really distant ecosystems over long distances. And then they can bring subsidies or material that's marine derived. So if they feed in the ocean, they grow, they swim up the stream, they bring this marine derived material in form of their own bodies or materials that they carry with them to these remote ecosystems and can supplement them. And salmon, for example, then get eaten by bears, and so the bears profit from this nutrients that come out of the ocean and get transported all the way up into the headwaters of the streams. But it's also important to the evolution of species because it is a key ecological mechanism, and it affects the fitness of individuals, which in turn then affects their reproductive success. And it affects the genetic structure within populations, so the way that individuals move in relation to each other affects on who they mate with and whose genes basically get transferred into the next generation. And like I said already, the dispersal between populations also has genetic and therefore evolutionary consequences. And those evolutionary consequences are apparent in the many different life histories that animals have evolved. So there's species like insects where the larvae don't really move and then the adult forms have wings and can move long distances. Or in case of many fishes, the larvae move long distances and the adults don't move that far. They are flying, walking, swimming, all these different ways evolved in response to ecological drivers and then evolved over time. But it's also important to management, and I wanted to spend a little more time talking about the importance of movement of fishes in relation to marine management and fisheries management. And there's three main things that I wanted to mention. There's stock assessments, then there are the effects of fishing on local areas, local reefs, and then there's the new management approaches such as marine protected areas, and movement has a large effect on those. So stock assessments are basically fisheries models where people try to estimate how many fish we can take out of what we call a stock, which is basically one unit of fish. And they can be large, they can be like all rockfish of one species along the west coast, for example, or they can be, do you have a question?
No. Sorry.
Or they can be smaller. And depending on how far individuals move, That determines how we define these stocks. So for example, tuna that move throughout the entire Pacific Ocean, you could consider the entire ocean as one stock. Whereas if you have local smaller fish that don't move that far, you should really consider their stocks at a much smaller scale and set fishing rates or fishing pressures at those smaller scales. And similarly, the effects of fishing then really differ between species that show different movement patterns. So if you fish one location, let's say you fish out here in Monterey really hard, you remove all the fish of a species that doesn't really move very much, you're not going to get new fish in this area probably for a long time, mm-hmm. unless mm-hmm. new ones are born or new larvae move in. But there's no adult movement into those fish areas. Whereas if it's a species that, like sardines that move all over the place, you fish out all the sardines one summer here, the next summer you're probably going to have just as many sardines because they just moved from somewhere else. So when you develop ideas or models to manage these fisheries, you really have to think about how far these species move. And then lastly, marine protected areas, which are a newer approach to marine management where you basically block off areas in the ocean from fishing. And obviously the movement of individuals in and out of these areas has large effects on or large consequences for their effectiveness. So for example, if these are these red things are little marine protected areas, somehow this is not showing up on the area. So this is a marine protected area. of a certain size, and this is one of a different size, if individuals can move in and out of these areas, or they cross the boundaries of these areas, then this area, this marine protected area, is going to be a lot less effective in protecting individuals than this, for example. So if the movement range of a species changes or increases, then the protection level that is provided by a given MPA is going to change. Similarly, the movement patterns of species matter. So if these are, again, the marine protected areas, and these striped areas are different types of habitats, then you can imagine that a marine protected area that which has a boundary that coincides with a given habitat is going to protect species that do not move into this different habitat. Whereas if they cross habitat types and individuals can move kind of freely between across this boundary, the protection level is different. Again, and similarly, if individuals migrate between different patches of habitat, that's going to affect the protection level provided by an MPA. Or if in a situation where an entire habitat is enclosed in a marine protected area, so you're going to have a really high level of protection. And then there's other factors that can affect the movement. Do you have a question?
How long can a fish live?
Oh, it depends. Some fish live really long times, over 100 years. And some fish live only 1 or 2 years. So it's really different for different species. So if, for example, the density of individuals changes in a marine protected area, as we expect after a while when there's no more fishing, and then this density has an effect on the movement range, so they move less at low densities, then you have a marine protected area for a while, there's going to be more fish, and then they start moving further. Then that, again, has an effect on the protection level provided by the marine protected area. So there's many different aspects of the movement, or many different aspects of the marine protected area in which you have to consider the movement of the species you target for protection. And so then when we think about movement, we have to consider not only the movement distance, obviously that's just kind of a straight linear distance between two points. We also have to consider the movement patterns. And what I mean by movement patterns are, there's basically three. Movements can be diffusive, which is demonstrated here, where you basically, you look at an individual at some point in time, and then it just keeps moving away from that point, but it never really returns to that point, at least intentionally. It might just kind of cross through that area again, but kind of keeps moving. For example, like sardines, they just kind of move throughout the ocean, or tuna, they never really return to one location. Then there's migrations, where individuals move kind of back and forth between two discrete areas, like many birds that fly south in the winter, they nest there, they come back in the summer, but they don't spend much time in between. They just visit these two separate habitats. And then lastly, there's bounded movements or home ranges, where an individual has a defined area that it moves back and forth over, but it rarely moves out of that area. And so we have to, if we just measure a distance, we also have to know which kind of movement pattern goes with that distance, because it has really different consequences for how we think about the movement. For example, if we measure a distance in this diffusive case, let's say over a year, that's going to be really different than if we measure a distance over a year in this area, because after 2 years, this individual is going to have moved twice as far, whereas this individual is going to just have gone back and forth over the years. So the long-term consequences are very different. So then for marine organisms, historically, we have thought much more about the larval dispersal. So I don't know if you all know, but most of the marine fishes that, at least that we find out here, they have large adults, and then they lay a lot of eggs, or they give birth to a lot of little larvae. And those larvae then can be transported by the currents far out into the ocean. Many of the rockfish, for example, out here have larvae that spend month out in the open ocean, and then at some point they return to the reef and they settle down. They often are found up in the kelp, and then they settle down and grow up, And then the larger adults, they usually don't leave those reefs again. At least they don't go out to the open ocean again. And so because of this potential of larvae to connect these distant populations, and the potential for long-distance movement, marine ecologists have largely thought about larval movement when they considered fish movement in the past. But recently, there has been an emphasis on adult movement as well, for three reasons, really. Well, first of all, there's more and more evidence that the larvae might actually not go that far. Their dispersal might be much more limited than we previously thought. And if that's the case, then adult movement, even over smaller spatial scales, becomes more important in comparison. And then second, there's much more emphasis now on the importance of movement in species interactions, such as predation or this transport of matter between different ecosystems that I talked about earlier. People really start thinking about that more because it has large consequences. Even if it doesn't affect the individual populations as much, it does affect the communities and distant ecosystems are connected by it. And they're not that much connected by the movement of larvae, for example, since they don't really transport any materials with them. And then lastly, like I said, spatially explicit management approaches such as marine protected areas. In order for those to work, you really need to know a lot more about what the adults do. You need to know what the larvae do too, but both movement types matter. And so when I started my dissertation, I then asked, well, what do we know about the movement of temperate reef fishes? And I started at a time when the marine protected areas here along the central coast that have been put in 4 years ago now, I think, were just beginning to be designed, and people thought about it a lot and thought how big they have to be and how far apart they have to be in order for individuals to be protected. And so I looked in the literature, and some people said, well, the most of the reef fish species we find here, they have spatial limited movement. Other people said, no, they actually continuously move up and down the coast. They never stop. They're just kind of moving north or south along the coast. Then different groups said, well, we don't really have to think about the adults because all that matters is where the larvae go. Fishermen said, well, they move all over the place because otherwise, why would I keep catching fish on reefs where I fish all the time? They must come from somewhere, right? And then lastly, people said, well, I guess we don't really know. And so I thought, well, that's a good topic then to investigate. And to really find out what we know and what we don't know, I started by reviewing the literature. And so I'll talk a little bit about what I found from past studies over the last 20, or actually longer, the last 40 years or so, that people have studied reef fishing along this coast. And then based on that review, I identified these two questions that we really don't know anything about, and that's how the variation in habitat, so for example, the presence and absence of kelp or changes in the relief of the rocky reef affect the home ranges or the movement of kelp forest fishes. And then this third aspect, how does the population density, so the number of fish in a given area, affect the movement of individuals? And so I'll talk about all three of those. But then looking at the literature, I ask, what are the movement distances of adult fish, and how do they vary among or within species? And then secondly, like I said, we also have to think about what pattern of movement do they exhibit? Do they have home ranges, or do they exhibit these diffusive directional movements along the coast? And then how good are the estimates that we can get from the literature? And so I looked at species basically from up here, Vancouver Island, all the way down to Southern California, which is basically the range of temperate reef fishes that have been studied along the west coast. There's not much information from further north. And then as you get further south, you get into the subtropical species, which are different. And I found 44 studies from the 1950s until 2008. And 26 species that have been studied in detail. I found some information on 38 species, but I only included species where people had looked at movement of more than 10 individuals, which is already pretty pretty small number, but that was my cutoff. And then I extracted the movement distances for each species, or for each individual for each species, and estimated movement distances by species, and tested, used a mathematical approach really to test for the movement patterns that these species exhibit. And so here's what I found for most species. This is just six species kind of as a representation of what I found for most. And so I'm showing you the distance on the x-axis here that individuals move, and then the number of individuals along the y-axis here that move the given distance. So in this case, see the brown rockfish, you see just under 40 individuals move almost nothing, and not at all. And then about 10 individuals move like around a kilometer and a half. And similar for the other species. And so when you look at all these species, you can see that most individuals don't go very far, but in almost all cases, there's some that go much further than the rest. And so these distributions of movement patterns then are difficult to describe because they're not what we call a normal distribution, where you would have a few individuals going a little bit, and most of them would be somewhere in the middle, and then there would be a few going long distances again. That's kind of a typical distribution that's easy to describe statistically.
Did you actually tag these fish to track them?
No, this is now all from the literature. So that's other people tagged them and published the results. I'll talk about the ones I tagged later. Do you have a question, too? No? Okay. Feel free to ask. So since it's not this normal distribution, I used them what's called the 75th percentile, and that's the movement distance for a given species that 75% of all individuals that I reported in here that I found moved less than that distance. That was my metric. So basically, what most of the individuals do, what 75% of them do, I call the movement distance for that species. And then if I plot all species combined now, you can see here's now the movement distance, and then here's the percent of species that moved a given distance or less. And so you can see 80% of the species, or over 80% of the species, moved less than 3 kilometers. And that's not very far, and really different from what people thought. They thought these are large reef fish, and people thought they're going to move a lot more than. We knew that, for example, small tropical reef fish on coral reefs, they don't go very far, but they're about this big. And so people thought, well, these rockfish or lingcod, they're going to go further. They're bigger, they need to go further. But it looks like that they don't. And then if you look at these, let me go back. So if you look just at those species that didn't move more than 3 kilometers in a little more detail, and that's all the ones here listed in yellow, you can see that of those over 80% of the species that have been studied, almost 60% don't go further than 500 meters. And so now we're talking, that's like really small. That's from here to Hopkins or something. And so, and then if you go up to 2.5 kilometers, but really 80% don't go further than a kilometer. So they basically stay within one reef. But then we have to now think about what that means as far as their movement patterns goes. So if they have a home range of this size, then that's really different than if they move this distance of, let's say, 1 kilometer every year, but they go in one direction. Then over the years, they would actually get further, right? Whereas if it's a home range, they're going to really stay in one place. And so we get these different predictions depending on the movement patterns. If the movement is diffusive or directional, the longer we study an individual, the further it's going to go. So we get this increasing relationship between time and movement distance on an individual level. Whereas if these movements are bounded or in a home range where an individual goes kind of back and forth over the same area, this relationship, at least after initial increases, should become independent of time because they don't go any further. They just go back and forth, and it doesn't matter how long we study them. And so I looked at this for the species where people had reported movement distance, again here on the y-axis, and then the number of days that they actually had studied individuals. And believe it or not, most people don't report that. So there's only these 12 species where people actually reported how long they had studied an individual. And none of these plots show a significant relationship between the movements, so which kind of suggests we're rather looking at something like this than this. If people had found this, we would find significant regressions in these between these points. And then to look at it in more detail, I summarized the data from all species using a statistical approach where I basically removed the mean movement distance of each species from every individual. And so I can plot them all in one graph. And so you see that we get a small initial increase when we fit a line through this, but then there's no more increase after about 600 days, so after about a year and a half, 2 years. We don't detect any further movement. So what that means is then that these individuals, they stay within an area. It takes us a little while to study and detect their whole movement range, because it takes us a little while to move over the entire home range. But if we study them for long enough, they stay within one place. They don't move any further. And so we can then conclude that there's, oops, and this doesn't show up, that they have home ranges, and that this, we're looking at this kind of distribution. And so, hold on, this is, yeah, so they, we're looking at this kind of movement. So they're moving back and forth within a given area, and they're not going any further over the years. So then, in summary, from the literature, I found that shallow temperate reef fishes, like rockfishes, greenlings, lingcod, don't move very far, and that they have these limited movement ranges, or home ranges. And yeah, that their movement is described by home ranges. And then that is a key consideration if we model the movement of fishes, or if we think about it for fisheries management. Because if these individuals don't go very far, in general, then local fishing pressure is really going to have a large effect on the local population, and new individuals are not going to move in from outside of a fish area. They're going to move in through reproduction or the larvae, but those going to take a long time to grow up, especially in long-lived and slow-growing species. And it also means that small marine protected areas can be effective in protecting these populations. If they don't move in and out of them, they don't get fished. And so that was kind of a relief, because it meant we don't have to have these huge areas that we protect, which would be nice, but which would be really hard to get political consensus to do. So we could say that even small areas are going to be effective, and we should implement them.
So are you saying that larger MPAs won't be any more effective than smaller ones?
good question. I mean, they are. They're going to protect more fish, right? So
A bigger area.
They protect a bigger area, and they protect more individuals. But if you look at an individual fish, yeah, no, it doesn't matter. It's going to be protected even by a small area. Of course, it's better to have a larger area protected. But the argument was, well, we're not going to get these large areas. These fish move all over the place, so why have them in the first place if they're not even going to protect the fish within that are within them, because they move in and out. And so we could show, well, actually, they don't move in and out. They have really small home ranges where they stay. And so even...
It's kind of like the fish that inhabit the pinnacles are usually an indigenous population of the pinnacles.
They stay there, yep, exactly.
Cool, okay.
Yeah. Okay, but so I also found that get some more cookies. You want to pass those around? Just give,
I'll do it.
Gotta have the cookies. Get those around.
Some cheese sticks too, young.
Yeah.
We're in the original.
I know, we've got to figure that out. Okay, so, but then I also, from looking at the literature, realized that we really don't know anything about how the variability in the habitat now affects these movement distances. And now I'm not talking about movement on the scale of hundreds of kilometers, but within reefs, and similarly how the population density affects the movement. And so to look at this, I then designed a study where we know that habitat and landscape features affect the movement of species. Like we know that from terrestrial species on land that has been studied a lot. And we also know that the movement response of a given species depends on the function of the habitat. So if the same habitat feature like kelp or something might have really different effects on different species depending on how they use it. And then to understand these differences, we have to study multiple species within the same location at the same time. So we can say, okay, there's one species reacts in this way, there's other species reacts in that way, and they did that at the same time, so we reduce any external factors that could affect their movement. And so I looked at two species to do that. I studied kelp greenling, and this is the males, and these are the females, they look really different, and then kelp rockfish, where you can't differentiate males and females. And these species are found within the same habitat in the kelp forest, but they use the kelp forest in really different ways. So the kelp greenling are closely associated with the rocky reef bottom, whereas the kelp rockfish are found on the reef, but they also are found up in the water column in the kelp. And then kelp greenling are typically by themselves, whereas kelp rockfish form these larger schools at times at least. And they feed on different stuff. So the greenling mostly feed on invertebrates, sessile invertebrates and crabs and small things between on the rocky reef, whereas kelp rockfish feed on those invertebrates too, but they also feed on pelagic little fish and pelagic invertebrates too. And they have different reproductive behaviors. So kelp greenling lay eggs, and the males actually guard the eggs. They just sit by their clutch, and then those little larvae hatch and then get washed out to sea, where kelp rockfish are life bearing, so they give life birth to their young, and then their larvae also get moved out into the open ocean.
But the live birth is larvae?
Yeah, they have, because they're not fully developed.
Not like perch?
No, not like perch. Perch, actually, the babies look basically like the adults, mm-hmm. whereas the larvae are tiny. And then to understand now how habitat variability affects the homing size of these species, I had to go through these three steps. So first, I had to quantify how big their home ranges are for multiple individuals. And then I had to identify what parts of the kelp forest habitat, what features are important to these species. So do they care about if there's kelp, or do they care about if there's a lot of sessile invertebrates? Do they care about the currents? And because the features that they care about most are most likely to affect the size of their home range. And then I had to investigate how those features that I identified in step two are actually going to affect the home range size of individuals. And so to do this, I used this acoustic array of buoys. And basically, this is out here, right at Lovers Point. So all the work I'm going to be talking about now was done right here at Lovers Point. And actually, the aquarium helped me a lot by letting me have my radio equipment here. And so I could communicate with these buoys that were out here at Lovers Point through a radio that was placed here at the aquarium. And then I set up these triangular sites with basically three of these buoys, 1, 2, 3. And then those buoys would listen to acoustic tags within those areas. And I had two study sites, or five study sites in over two time periods, one from 2003 to 2005 out here in the deeper water, and then from 2007 to 2008 in the kelp, in those yellow areas.
What's the depth of the water there?
This is 20 meters here, this line.
Yeah.
And so these larger ones were between 10 and 20 meters, and then these fish show up. And then I would go out there and I would dive with my little fishing pole and I would look for these fish. And when I saw one, I would have a little lure or bait and lower it right in front of their mouth, and they would actually then take it and I would reel them in. And I can't really see, but I already have one in the bag here. And then I would bring them up to the boat and do a little surgery on them. So we would put them in a bucket with some narcotic, and so they would pass out. And I would implant these little small acoustic tags in their bellies and then stitch them up, or staple them actually, with these surgical staples that I guess they use for cats and dogs. I got them from that supply. And those staples would then, they would heal and the staples would fall out after a little while. And then I would release them. And I would also put this external tag on them so I could recognize them again. And then these small little tags would send out an acoustic signal that was that I could use to identify individuals. So each tag had a different signal, and I could tell which fish was which by listening to the signals of these tags. And they send them out every 5 minutes or so for a year or a year and a half, and up to 2 years depending on the size of the tag. And then so then I would put these fish back. And then this array would listen to and locate them on the reef. So this is like a kind of a map of the seafloor. And then by triangulating their position, the buoys would they would actually radio back a signal, and then I had a radio station here on the computer that would then calculate where this fish was at a certain point in time. And then I would basically get these tracks of individuals. So different colors are different individuals here. And so every 5 minutes, I would get one of those locations, and then I could see how they move through the habitat in real time.
Could you track them from one triangle to another, or were they all...
No, I couldn't. The problem is those buoys are really expensive, and so I only have one set. And so I had to move it between those three triangles. So I would listen to, say, this one for a week. Then I would come out, I would move them all over here, listen to that one for a week, and kind of rotate through year round. There's a lot of diving. and I tried to do it, or I managed for 2 years to do it really year round, and then some years I had to take them out in the winter because if I can't get to them, I didn't want to have them out here in a storm.
Did you put them in with augers?
Yeah, we had big concrete blocks to put them in, and then there was a chain that basically went down too. So you don't want the buoys to move very much because then that messes up your signal. But they can calibrate with each other, so they kind of know where they are. And so then I can use these tracks and generate these home range estimates. And I used an approach that's called kernel density estimation, which basically generates these curves. So this is kind of a three-dimensional figure of two individuals. And so you get this area, and then you get this curve above the area that shows you how often an individual is found in a certain location. So the higher these curves, the more often an individual is found there. And then if you look at that in two dimensions, you can outline these use areas. So this individual was 95% of the time was found within this red line. And then the colors indicate that it was most often found right in this spot, and then less as you get towards the outside ranges. And it was never found outside this blue area. And so you can then use that to estimate the size of the area that they move over. And you can look at how they use their habitat. So the gray actually is kind of, is a representation of the rocky reef. So all this kind of darker stuff is reef. And then the just plain gray is sand. And so you can see this fish really just mostly hung out right at this edge of this reef here. And then went into sand a little bit and went onto the reef a little bit. And so using those estimates, I then calculated the home range size for the two different species. And plotted basically, again, individual movement. And so these are not distances now, these are the home range areas in square meters. So for kerbock fish, on average, those home ranges were about 700 square meters. And that's pretty small area. That's like I know how much that is in feet, but that's not, I don't have a good comparison to it. And, yeah, that's small, yeah. And the kelp greening had similar size home ranges. The males around 600 square meters and the females about 1200, so twice as big as the males, but still pretty small. But interestingly, they had this variability in their home range size. So most individuals were around here, but then there were some that moved further, that had larger areas. Same here for the females too. And so the variability within the species was actually larger than the variability among species. And that's what I really wanted to look at. So now I wanted to find out what drives those variabilities in home range size. Why do some individuals move at larger areas than others? And so we know that within the home range, since they don't leave it, all the resources that they need, like food and shelter and those kind of things, have to be included within the home range, right? And we can also assume that individuals associate with important habitat features more often than things that they don't care about. So if they care about shelter, they're going to be more often found at one of these shelters that's within their home ranges than if they care about, let's say, food resources. They're going to be found in the place where there's most food. And so we can then use this internal home range structure that I showed you, this curve, to identify those important habitat features. And in order to do that, I sampled the habitat within those triangles. And so these are now two of those triangles that are next to each other. Those are the yellow ones in the kelp. And at these plots, each blue dot basically is one plot where I characterize the habitat. And so I looked at the physical substrate and the substrate cover. So that's basically like the UPC that we do for ReefCheck. Mm-hmm. And then at the density of the structure providing algae. So those are the kelps. So basically like the algae swath transects that we do. But I spatially referenced them. So for each of these plots, I knew where it was by using a GPS and laying out a grid throughout those triangles. And then I can use this characterization of the habitat to overlay it with their home ranges. And so now this home range, I'm showing you the entire home range here in red, and then the most used area in yellow. And for each plot, then I assigned it to either the red or the yellow, the outer home range or the inner, the more important home range area, and then compared to see if there's a difference in the habitat in this yellow, in this core area, compared to this outer home range area. And there's some statistical analysis that you can use to do that. And then what I found for kelp greening, basically, is that the physical substrate, so the if it was rock or sand or cobble or boulder, that was important to them. But that's not surprising because they're really closely associated with the reef and they are found on the reef. But what was also important was the physical substrate cover. So the algae growing, the small like red algae and the sessile invertebrates growing on the rocky reef were different in that core area compared to the outer home range area. And that was mostly driven that they liked to, the core area was more, there was more red algae cover, more sessile invertebrates than in the outer home range area. But the structure forming algae, so the kelps, didn't differ between the core area and the outer home range area. And for kelp rockfish, it was exactly the opposite. So there was no difference in the physical substrate. There was no difference in the substrate cover, the red algae, the sessile invertebrates. But the distribution of kelp was different. There was much more kelp in their core area compared to the entire home range. And so what that means then is that for kelp greening, it seems like the most important feature of the kelp forest habitat is the red algae that is growing on the rocky reef. And that's where they like to be. And that is the habitat they use. And that makes sense because that's where their food is found. And they like to forage on those small crustaceans that are found within the red algae. And then the kelp rockfish, for them, the kelp seems to be the most important feature, and that's where they're often found in high up in the kelp, and they're hiding. They provide the use of the structure that the kelp provides as cover, as shelter from predators, but also as concealment, and they feed from within the kelp on small little other fish or invertebrates. And so within the kelp forest, then, these two species show this different habitat use and have shown that different habitats are important, different features of that habitat are important to them. And so now, I went through the first two steps, so I figured out how big their home ranges are. I showed that some features of this kelp forest habitat are important to one species and not to the other. But so now, my real question was now, so how do these features affect their home range size? And, to look at that, I used the fact that the algal abundance, so red algae and kelp, varies spatially within the rocky reach. So there's areas where you have high abundance of kelp or low abundance of red algae, and then there's other areas where it's the other way around. And then I looked if the abundance of kelp has an effect on the home range size of the kelp rockfish that I trap. And so if you then do the statistical, or if you plot now the home range size of the individuals that are found within kelp against the one that are found outside of kelp, you can see they have a larger home range when they're found within kelp. And if you look at a spatial gradient over the entire reef now, you find a lot of kelp when you're basically, this is now plotted in relation to the kelp forest. So when you're in the middle of it, obviously there's a lot of kelp. When you're on the edge of the kelp forest, there's less individual kelp plants. And then once you're out of the kelp forest, there's no kelp, obviously. And if you plot the home range size now of individuals that are found in these different locations, you get exactly the same pattern. So if there's kelp, they have large home ranges. And if there's no kelp, they have smaller home ranges. And so that's consistent with the idea that they use this kelp as cover and shelter, because they can move around without leaving their cover when there's kelp present. But if they're in an area where there's no kelp, they reduce their home range size, they use the reef as shelter, or they don't go as far because they don't want to go out in the open. And so then what about kelp greening? So does red algae affect the home range size of kelp greening? I did a slightly different test here, but basically I plotted the percent cover of red algae versus the home range size of individual kelp greening that I tagged. And so you can see there's this negative relationship. So the more red algae there's, the less far they go. And again, then, if we plot red algae in proximity to the kelp forest, we find less red algae when you're in the thick of the kelp forest, because there's a thick kelp canopy, and that reduces the light that reaches the bottom of the reef. And so there's less red algae there. Then as you get to the edge of the kelp forest, red algae increases because there's less light competition from the kelp. And then as you get deeper, red algae decreases again because you just don't have enough light anymore for any algae to grow. And then if you plot kelp greening home range sizes over that same gradient, you get the opposite pattern. So they have large home ranges when there's little red algae. They have small home ranges when there's a lot of red algae, and then same out there in the deeper water. And so that's consistent with the idea that they use this red algae as their foraging habitat. Because if there's a lot of red algae, that means there's a lot of their food. And so they don't have to go as far. They just stay there, and they have enough resources available to them. Whereas if there's not as much red algae, they have to go further to satisfy their nutritional needs or their food. And so we find these opposing patterns for these two species within the same habitat and at the same time. So kelp greening have large home ranges when there's little red algae, whereas kelp rockfish have large home ranges when there's a lot of algae, and the greening have small home ranges when there's a lot of algae, whereas kelp rockfish have small home ranges when there's little algae. And both of these responses to this variability in the habitat are consistent with the way in which they use that habitat. And so basically then what I have shown is that the variation of a habitat feature can affect the home range size, and therefore temporal variation of this habitat feature can affect the species, and it can affect them differently depending on how they use this habitat. And that's important also for marine protected areas, because we expect the habitat to change with protection. And if these changes affect the movement of different species differently, then we have to consider that when we design marine protected areas, because some species are going to increase their home range, others going to decrease their home range. And so an MPA of a given size is going to have different effects on different species over time. And also, as always, we think about climate change. And so in the light of climate change, as we expect algae to change as temperature regimes change, some species going to react to that by increasing their movement range. And so maybe they can move out of the way. They can migrate with the climate change. They can go up north. But other species, as the algae, for example, goes away, they're going to reduce their home range size. And so they're basically stuck there, at least on an individual level. And so that has important implications that way, too. But so we need another cookie break. All right, any questions?
So during the winter, the cup gets ripped out.
Yeah.
Do then the cup rockfish move reef to reef, and then when the cup grows, they stay there, or they go back, or does that not affect them?
No, so they go less far if there's no cup, right? So they don't. In the winter when there's no cup, they kind of hunker down. So their home range really gets smaller in the winter. They sit in one spot on the reef, and then as the cup comes up again, they'll venture out further.
Was there a lot of overlap in the home ranges of the species of fish?
Yeah. You mean the individuals?
Individuals.
Yeah. Actually, that's a good point. So there's a real difference between home ranges and territories. And the home ranges, basically, they overlap. They don't defend them or anything. So yeah, there was a lot of overlap, and they all move across each other's home ranges. And then some species have territories where they fight as soon as another individual comes in. I didn't look at that. As far as the movement goes?
Yeah, like how it affects their
mobility. I don't know. I don't think anybody has looked at that. I know somebody has looked at how acidification. So acidification is the ocean, or the thought is that the ocean is going to get more and more sour as the more CO2 we have in the atmosphere, because it gets absorbed by the ocean, and that changes the pH. And so people have been thinking about a lot how that's going to affect organisms, but not really. Nobody has looked at this level of organization yet. They're mostly thinking about shells and if it's going to dissolve the shells of individuals. But I know of one study where they have looked at the sensory, the effect of acidification on smell, and I think it was in fishes, and it changed it. So if they use smell to orient themselves, which a lot of fish do, it might have an effect on how they move, or if they can find locations again. So there might be an effect, but I don't think it's very well understood. Other questions? Okay, well, I'm almost done. I'm going to talk a little bit about another study now that I did to look at the effect of population density on movement. And so density-dependent population regulation is an aspect of reef fish ecology, or ecology in general, that has been studied a lot. Because the thought is, as the population gets more dense, in order for this population to not get out of control, something has to affect how many individuals can be in an area. And the more individuals there are, the more of them are going to die, or they're going to migrate out, or something that regulates the population at a certain level. Because typically populations don't just increase further and further, right? They stay at a certain level, and maybe because other species prey on them, or because there's not enough resources, individuals start dying at a higher rate as populations get denser. But nobody really has looked at the effect of that on movement, for at least not for temperate reef fishes. There are a few studies on coral reef fishes, and people have shown that mortality increases. And there's one study that has shown for tropical reef fish that movement changed with population density. But for temperate reef fishes, nobody really knew. And since there is all these marine protected areas put in place, where we expect densities to increase, we were wondering what would happen to the movement of these fishes. And so I looked at kelp greenling for this, and we had kind of two hypotheses. So as population density increases, there's two possibilities. If that increases antagonistic interactions, so they start fighting because they get more and more crowded and resources become, they would have then territories where they start pushing each other out of the way. We would expect an inverse relationship. So the more fish there are, the smaller their home ranges would get, because every time they bump into each other, they wouldn't really go any further. On the other hand, if they don't have these antagonistic interactions, then resources become limiting, because the more fish there are, the less resources, the less food there is for each individual. We would expect a positive relationship, so we would expect their home ranges to get larger with increasing densities. And so I set up an experiment to test this. And basically I used the same approach at different sites, again out here at Lover's Point. This time I had four study sites where I put these three buoys again to look at tagged fish. And then what I did, I tagged the fish in the fall and then monitored their movement for 9 months in those four areas, again cycling those buoys through. And then I reduced the density in half of these sites after 9 months, and then I looked at their movement again 9 months after the experimental manipulation.
How did you reduce the density?
I caught them, yeah.
Were they good?
No, I put them somewhere else. Okay. So this is actually, it's another one of those stories where they, so I thought, so it's out here at Lover's Point, right? So I thought if I drive around all the way around Point Pinos, I put them there, that's far enough away. 2 days later, they were all back.
2 days later.
Yeah, they came right back. And luckily, I tagged them, so I put a little visual tag on them. And thought, well, we'll see what happens. And yeah, they came right back. So then I had to move them further.
Homing fish.
So what kind of sample size have you got? What's the population within one of these?
So I had, in those, I had basically identified 16 reefs. Those are these little darker areas here. And then I tagged one fish on each reef, and there were approximately between, I don't know, between 3 and 7 other fish on each of those. So, and I took, from 8 of those reefs, I basically reduced the density by half, so I took 50% of the fish found on that reef.
So you said that when you moved the fish,
yeah,
like it came back,
yeah,
have you noticed that over a period of time, like, it seems like the studies are, you know, over a couple of years,
yeah,
that some of the fishes have migrated away from their, or they just have basically have like a home point that,
yeah,
they
have. So that's kind of an unnatural thing. Like they don't naturally get moved that far. But if you do it, they come back. And that's really different than if they are in their normal spot, they don't go that far. No, I didn't lose, I mean, I lost some from my study area, but not more than you would expect just due to natural mortality. So it didn't seem like they migrated out. So this is just to show you basically what I did. So I had the densities on the treatment and the control reefs. So the reefs that I manipulated and the reefs where I didn't do anything, they were similar before I removed any fish. Then I reduced it by about 50% on the treatment reef after the manipulation, and it stayed nearly the same on the control reefs. And so then the question is, what does that do to the home range size of individuals on these reefs? And so here I'm showing you now the home range size before I reduced the density on all 16 reefs, and these are not really significantly different. And then after I reduced the density, and so the home range size decreased significantly on the reefs where I removed the density by 50%. And this looks like it changed here, but they are actually not significantly different. So it didn't change on the reefs where I didn't do anything. And so basically we get this positive relationship. So reduction in population density means reduction in home range size. So at higher densities, they move further than at lower densities. And that's what we would predict if the resources are limiting. So they're not crowding each other, they're not fighting. But at higher densities, there's less food available, and so individuals have to go further to satisfy their resource needs. And that's consistent with the other study, too, because for the kelp feeling, if you remember, their home ranges were inversely related to the density of red algae. And so if there's a lot of red algae, there's a lot of food, they have small home ranges. If there's little red algae, there's less food, and they have larger home ranges. And similarly, if there's a lot of individuals, they have larger home ranges because there's little food. And if there's few individuals, they have smaller home ranges because there's enough food for them. And so, yeah, so that means, and then again, for marine protected areas, that means that as over time the densities increase in these marine protected areas, they're going to get larger home ranges, at least for this species, and potentially move out of those marine protected areas more than they do in the beginning when densities are low. Okay, so overall, I showed that temperate reef fishes have small, limited movement, and that they show home ranges, and that they exhibit this home range behavior, and that their home ranges are dependent on the habitat and the way in which they use the habitat, as well as the population density of species in those habitats. Okay, that's it.